Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Yeah, how's it going?
Yeah, that's a nice welcome. yeah, my name is Sigrid Gramlinger, and I'm talking about GDPR today. And this is a topic that's quite, it's getting more urgent now, but it's not over on May 25. So, yeah. I'll tell you more. So at first about me, my name is Sigrid Gramlinger-Moser. I have a master in vocational education and training. So I come originally from business education, kind of. I'm creating websites since 2004. I am from Austria. I live close to Vienna. Yeah, I my own company is called WebGras, and I'm specializing exclusively on Joomla since 2010. I've initiated Joomla Day Austria and Joomla User Group Vienna with some others. Since January, I'm certified GDPR consultant in Austria because I realized this is really a topic. It's quite interesting. I think there are lots of gains for personal, for all of us, and also for the businesses we are doing. Yeah, and for GDPR compliance, since the Joomla World Conference in Rome, Peter Martin and me, we were developing a tool for GDPR compliance to do the documentation because you have to do your own processing activities. Yeah, and we're online for like a few, maybe 10 days or 2 weeks. Yeah, so that's Data2EU. We also try to provide information there about GDPR. Yeah, if you have any links or anything, send it to us and we'll try to provide it for you as well. So, first, what is GDPR? I will also go to some general parts because it's important to use the same words, to know the definitions, to make clear what we're talking about. So GDPR is for General Data Protection Regulation. It's an EU regulation. So it's actually it's there for 2 years, but it will take effect on May 25 in 2018. And yeah, it's a regulation means the countries don't have to make their own laws. It will just take effect on May 25th. So the countries, they can add some more stuff, so they can give some more precise information, but the basis is the same for all European countries. So, and actually GDPR was installed to simplify and enhance the transfer of personal data between the organizations in different countries while protecting personal data in an appropriate and secure way. So it's a lot about data security, actually. And in the consultings I'm doing, people are aware about personal data, but then now it's time to really do the security stuff, like do backups also for your office PC and stuff. So they're lock the cupboards where you keep your paper files, stuff like this. So very basic stuff. And that's the big chance now for many businesses, I think, to get appropriate security level. Okay, within GDPR, there are some terms. The first is the data subjects, that's the concerned persons. So that's we are as individuals. Then we have the controller. If I gather information by somebody, I'm responsible for this data. So I'm the controller of this data. I have to secure this data and I have to inform the people why, how long, and all this stuff, why I'm doing this. Then I, as a controller, I have to do a record of all my processing activities, a processing index. And this is also important part to start with because at one point you might find out what data you've stored, then you can go back and don't have to start at that point when you need it. A processor is somebody that I am, I gather through a contact form data from my customers. So I'm the controller. And my IT provider, for example, because the website is stored somewhere at my IT provider, so he or she or the company is the processor. So, and I have to make sure I'm using reliable processors. So later on I will explain. So I need to, for example, make contracts. No, I have to make contracts with IT providers to ensure they are working on my behalf. So a processor is somebody who's processing data on behalf of somebody else. There are data protection officers. That's an legal obligation for companies who are doing data protection on like on large scale and on especially specific categories. I'll show that later. But the data protection officer for the businesses I'm consulting, small and medium-sized businesses, so far none of them needed one. But for example, in Germany, it's more precise. For example, if you have a company with more than 9 people working on a digital device, you will need it. There's some more things, but you will need a data protection officer.
And they actually have to work with personalized data.
Okay, yeah, that's more precise.
So then
yeah.
If you've got more of 9 of them,
yeah,
then you have to have one.
Yeah.
If you got 2, I don't know, developers and 5 cleaning women, no problem.
So yeah, yeah. Okay, they have to work with. So, but there's in different countries, there's additions to that to make it to specify it more. And there is in all the countries, there are data protection authorities, and they either they give information, or for example, in Austria, there's a lot of information about the Chamber of Commerce. So there's institutions that will provide you with templates or other stuff. So if you get out on the internet and find stuff, try to find it from a reliable source, because there's many stuff going on right now. So, and what is personal data actually? Personal data is all data yet of an identifiable natural person, and or either that is directly about someone, or it can be traced back to a person. And there's always the discussion about IP address, and there's no final decision about if an IP address is a personal data or not. So there will be stuffs going on. So like half a year ago, there was different discussion, and things are changing. So after May 25, there will be more stuff going on, and more stuff will be clarified, and we'll get more information, and then we'll know more for some details. So, but personal data is if you're doing, for example, your processing index, you don't have to write like first name, last name, everything. You can collect it under some main terms like address data, name data, contact data, or there's more examples like timesheets, IP address, geographic location, event registration. Data, if you always know for a specific person, also payment details, bank accounts, this stuff, social media contacts, yeah, everything that's for, there's long lists if you are looking for more details. So. And there's also personal data, special categories, and it's a list of specific categories, and there's not more. So for example, like there's no credit card details. It's a sensitive data, but it's not a special category just because it's a contact, a credit card information. You have to take special care for credit card or payment information, but it's not a specific category. It's only these ones that are there, like racial or ethnic origin, political opinions, and all these things. And if you're processing this kind of data, you have to take more precaution, more measures. You might need a data processing impact analysis, so assessment. So there's more stuff to going on if you process actually this data, but on a large scale. I was consulting with an event organ, or they're selling tickets for events. And sometimes like they have gay and lesbian events, they have religious events, and they were like, do we need to do this stuff now? But they are selling tickets. So their main business is selling tickets, and it's not about people's sexual orientation or about religious beliefs. So if your core is selling tickets, then you're not actually processing on a large scale this kind of data. You still have to secure it, but it doesn't mean automatically your core business is specific data.
Can I ask a quick question? What about if that data is optional? So
yeah.
They don't have to fill it in. Does
yeah.
It still have to be protected?
Is it still have
is
to
it
be?
Still part of the GDPR?
Sure.
Yeah.
As soon as you get data, it's personal data,
okay.
It's about GDPR. Yeah.
Can I also ask a question?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if this is better now at the end. For example, if you take, let's say, email addresses of a website which are publicly visible,
yeah.
And it's an email address which is presented as part of the company, but it's obviously connected to one person.
Yeah.
Does that cover this?
But personal data is usually you have to get it from the concerned person.
Yeah.
So if you don't, you have to make sure it's there voluntarily. But if it's a company employee, you don't know if to put the email address there voluntarily. So you have to be careful, because it might be in some contract within the company, they have to be on the website,
yeah.
They have to sign that, but it's not for free will, kind of.
So it's a gray area.
Yes,
okay.
Yeah. So legal basis. Actually, you're not allowed to process any of that data, except if you have a legal basis, a legal reason for this, a purpose. Okay, a purpose is something different, but if you have a legal basis, you're allowed to process this data. And so whenever you're processing this personal data, you have to find a legal basis. So there's only a few. The first, of course, is, but it's a rather weak one, is the person has given consent. And for children, there's a certain age, and that's also different in the countries. The GDPR says it's 16, but in Austria, for example, it's 14. I think in Germany, it's 13. So it's different in different countries. And under that age, the parents have to give consent. So you have to make sure if you're addressing children or people under that age, the parents are giving consent. Then, of course, you can collect personal data to fulfill a contract. You have to. Otherwise, you, for example, sending something, of course, you have to get a delivery address and you have to store it, but only as long as you need it. You have a legal obligation, you have to write invoices, of course you have to save that data. You have employees, you have to send the information to the social security, social insurance, whatever, of course you have to do that. A protection of vital interests, so that's all the doctors and hospitals. Or if you have addressing children for like summer camps or anything and they have allergies, of course you have to store that information, but only as long as you need it. Of course, the task for public interest, official authorities, they are allowed to store the information. And there's the last one, it's the legitimate interests by controller. So that's all the marketing issues about that. And it's the concerned person has an interest that the data is not processed or just taken. But you as a controller, you also have interests. For example, you need to run your business, you need to make money, you need to protect your service for IP addresses, for example, or you need to make a return. So if your legitimate interest is higher as of the person, then you're allowed to store or process this information. But also it depends on the kind of information, because the legitimate interest is not valid for the specific categories I've shown to you. So I cannot decide, it's very important for me to store sexual orientation, I'm not allowed to. That's only for normal data, like name, address, also payment details, stuff like this, because it's not specific categories.
Sorry, about the children.
Yeah.
How can you guarantee that a person is a child or not?
There's the first of the principles. It's lawfulness, fairness, and transparency. If you ask, are you over 16, and the person is answering yes, it's one point. It depends on what you're doing with that data. Mm-hmm. Also, is it just to get the name or an email address? I would say that's enough. But you have to look into your case, what's going on there. But to make sure, if you're specifically like having games for children, then I would say it's not enough, for example.
No, the opposite way around. If you're having stuff, it's already, you have to be an adult
mm-hmm.
to use this site.
Yeah.
Is it sufficient that you have a checkbox that says, I guarantee that I'm an adult?
It could be. It depends. I could not say in general right now. So
okay,
I would
so
have to say.
Another gray area.
No, it's not, I think.
No.
If you're addressing children, then you have to make sure you have the consent of the parents.
Yeah,
but if it's a general like business website or anything, you don't have to ask everybody if he or she is over 16. It doesn't make sense. And that's not what GDPR about.
No, but I run a website that asks, are you over 13?
Yeah.
I believe that's the age for the country. It's not my business to know these things. But and of course, a child could just check the box. They're just children.
Yeah.
So we don't know for 100% for sure that they are an adult.
Yeah. There's a comment.
But that's the same as any data that somebody submits.
Yeah.
You don't know 100% for sure that it's their email address.
Yeah.
It's no difference.
Yeah.
Well, you do send an email to them and they have to reply, confirm,
possibly.
And therefore you do know it's their address.
Yeah. Yeah, but maybe we can continue this discussion later because it's a very specific thing and I want to continue. So the principles of GDPR, it's also important because when you think through your cases, to go back to these principles, why and how you're storing or processing the data. So the first one would be lawfulness, fairness, and transparency. And that's nothing really new. And transparency is really an important part, I think. To be transparent, why you're keeping that data, what you're doing with it, to let the people know. The next one is you have to have a purpose limitation. So if you're collecting email addresses to sending a newsletter, use it for sending newsletters. Don't use it for anything else. Don't give it to somebody else. Stay with the purpose you collected it for. If you collected it for online shop to send the data, use it to send the product. So use it to send the product. Don't give it to somebody else. Be transparent and keep to the original purpose. Because if you change the purpose later on, you have to inform the people. You can do that, but you have to inform them. Data minimization. Only store the data you need or process the data. Ask only for, you don't need a birth date to send an email newsletter. Ask for the email address to send it.
But it's it could be, it's optional. So it's mandatory to have the newsletter, the email address, of course.
Yeah.
But you can ask for the name.
Yeah, there's a really new discussion going on about it. Why would you need it? Why would you offer that field there to send a newsletter?
Make it personalization to say.
Okay, that would be a name to personalization. Yeah. You can make it a mandatory field and people can provide it. But then you'd still have the problem. How would you address those people in the newsletter?
I think the most exciting question is what about the old data?
Yeah.
Can you say something about that?
Yeah, there was just, you can contact me later. There was just yesterday a newsletter about re-opt-in.
Mm-hmm.
If you have done it now in the correct way, you don't have to resend, re-ask for it, because that's also a gray zone, actually.
Mm-hmm.
So, I can show you that information, so. Accuracy. You have to make sure the data you have is not changed or anything, so that it's the data you collected. You have to provide that actually, that nobody else is like with technical and organizational measures, so that nobody else is changing the data or anything. Storage limitation. You're not allowed to store the data forever. Only as long as you need it. For like invoices, for example, there's like 5, 6, 7 years from your law, but not any longer. If you have contact form data, you don't need that after you've answered that email for 3 years. Maybe like for 2 months or so, but then get rid of it, delete it. You don't need that. Integrity and confidentiality. You have to make sure the data is not changed and it's and only the people see it who are allowed or should see it. So also in bigger companies, marketing only should see marketing, accounting only should see accounting, and employee data also should not be seen by everybody. But that's also like kind of logical. Accountability. The controller of the data is accountable for the stuff he or she's doing. So if the authority comes and checks on you, or if any the concerned persons want to know something, it's a legal obligation to show them, to tell them. So be prepared that somebody asks what you're doing. Was there a question? No. Okay. And there's some other two important principles. Oh, there's a typo. Privacy by design and privacy by default. Privacy by design is if there's checkboxes, they shouldn't be pre-checked. Yes, I confirm, I want to get this newsletter. It's not allowed to have it pre-checked. And also, if you're taking part in a prize draw or anything, or also if you register for any kind of seminar or information or so, then often it was, yes, I want to take part, and at the same time, I you can send me advertisement or whatever. So that's not allowed anymore. You have to make it two checkboxes. Yes, I want to take part, and yes, you're allowed to send me something, and both shouldn't be pre-checked. So that's a privacy by design and privacy by default, and you can derive many things by these principles.
Or dependency.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to take part, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, and the concerned people, they have, it's also new, they have lots of rights or more rights now. So on the one hand, you have to give them the information, what, why, where, and how long you save the data. And also, you have the obligation to inform them. So if somebody's coming asking you what you have stored about me, you have 1 month time, and you have to tell them what data you have stored about them, personal data. So, and then they can request to the data to be corrected, to cancellation or removal. Also the restriction of processing, so like, oh, I only want it for your legal purpose, or but no more newsletters. They have the right of data portability, so you can you have to be able to export the data, so you can move it to another platform, and that's still not clear how this will work. It needs to be like an easily used format, like CSV or something. But there's, I can't imagine that you can export your data from Facebook and put it to some other platform. Yeah?
Just a quick question. You use the word processing a lot.
Yeah.
What does that cover?
Everything.
Just looking at
writing, it? No. Writing, saving, storing, changing, copying, deleting. If you just look at it, I would say, no, but if you start thinking what you could do with it and do stuff, then yes.
Stop
processing.
Yeah, that's not
Sorry, never So, how can I comply? First thing, what's visible to the outside, it's a privacy statement on your website, for example, or in your general terms. You have to update that and tell what you're doing with the data. Consider privacy by default and privacy by design. In your forms, on your website, whatever you have. You have to do a record of processing activities. You have to do the processing activities, and you also have to tell how you, like the technical organizational measures, how you secure it. You have to make contracts with your processors, so that's the one you send the data to. So your clients will also approach you because you are handling their data, probably. Check if you need a data protection impact assessment, so that's if you're dealing with lots of sensitive data, for example. There's some criteria, I don't want to go into detail there because it's very specific. You can do two more sessions about the topic, also about the data protection officer. So, and provide appropriate security measures so that the data is secured. Yeah, I'll go shortly now into what is a processing index, what you have to do, that's your documentation, and that's a very central point where to start with, because from there then you know what are your processors, what is your what are the TOMs you have to do. So in the processing index you can do it on paper, you can use Word, you can use Excel, there's tools outside, like we have with the Data2EU, but you can do it however you like. What you have to put there is the name and the contact of the controller, so that's you yourself, of a representative if you have one. I was just discussing it yesterday with Junior also about common controllers. So if you have shared responsibilities and the data protection officer, and then you have to state your processing activities, and for each of the processing activities. You need the purpose of the processing. So there could be accounting, for example, or email marketing, or stuff like this. You have to write the categories of concerned persons. So for accounting, that would be your customers, this would be suppliers. I'll give you a detail in a second. You have to write data categories. Data categories is name, address, VAT number, stuff like this. That's all the stuff I already told you. Then you have to give the legal basis why you are, why you are processing this data, like it's a contract or it's a law or stuff like this. You also have to state the deleting deadlines. And that's also why I think this processing index is important, because then you can go back and see, okay, oh, I say that I would delete that after 3 years. So now it's 3 years, I have to go and delete it. You have categories of recipients. So if you're transferring the data to somebody else, like my accounting, also my accountant is getting this data. I have to state that there. Or my tax consultant, something like this. For IT stuff, it would be IT provider, or whoever's getting also the data. And that's, of course, or marketing agency, because they are doing the newsletter, they will get the newsletter subscribers. And you have, if the categories of the recipients, you can state general categories like IT provider, as long as they are within the European Union. As long as you transfer data within the European Union, and that's what GDPR for, the data should be safe, because everybody has to do the same stuff. But if you're transferring to other countries, there's different levels. One is the ones the European Union has contracts or guarantees with. That's like Switzerland, Norway. Some countries, and there's others, all the other ones. And like there's always a privacy shield, but it's there only as long as it's there. It could be removed anyway. So if companies are there in America, they say, yeah, they're in the privacy shield, but privacy shield is a self-certification, so they do the self stuff, so it's not very, on a long term, not very reliable, I would say. So try to stay within the European Union, because then you are sure that it's there. Yeah?
Question about the deadlines. Who decides the deadlines?
There's, yeah. For example, in Austria, there's a long list you can look at. So it's lots of deadlines from the law, like for employees, for example. There's some for like accounting, that's also by the law and stuff like this. And the other, you have to consider, I mean, how long do you need the contact form data? Yeah? There's also some say 2 months, some say 6 months, but that's, we will have to figure out in the next month. There's no legal advice. I cannot tell you.
Yeah,
it's this.
There,
yeah,
there must be, because
yeah, but we don't know yet.
10 years.
Yeah. For newsletter subscribers, you can say until cancellation, for example.
Yeah, okay.
That should be okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because it's in consent, and
yeah,
they if they have the chance always to resign,
yeah.
Until cancellation is also a deadline.
Okay,
yeah.
Then there is a list in Germany that would be, of course, very helpful.
Yeah,
we want to
there's,
make it.
I know for Austria there's one, and more than half is for employee stuff.
Right.
So okay. So and now I have here an example for like the processing index, like a newsletter. So the purpose would be sending emails for events and products and stuff. The categories of concerned persons would be subscribers and clients. Data categories would be name, IP address. The legal basis would be consent, because I've asked them before, and they said yes, they will. Deleting headlines, we had until cancellation. Categories of recipients would be the email provider, maybe like something like MailChimp. But they are in the US, you have to state them there by name. And the privacy shield. For example, if you're using Archimailing that's stored on your own server, then you don't have to maybe provide your IT provider, email provider. But then it's you're self-storing the data. That helps a lot in that case. And they are just about to be, they will publish a new version, which will help a lot for GDPR.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so if you have processors, and you always will have processors. If you say, no, I don't, that's not true. So you have processors, you're transmitting data to them. They're the recipients of the personal data, that's your processors. You have to check if they're GDPR compliant. So if they're also doing this kind of stuff and thought about it. And you have to choose ones that are GDPR compliant. You have to check where are they situated. Are they within the European Union? Then you're safe, because they have to do the same stuff. Yeah, they have to be reliable. And you, if you're doing you have to do a contract with them. And a part of the contract is also the technical and organizational measures. And there should be stated very clearly how they're going to secure and save the data. And you have to state them in your privacy statement. So you have to make sure that the people know where you're transmitting the data to. And that's if you have, or everybody has processors, if you have processors. On the other side, you are a processor for your customers or for your clients. There's also some stuff you have to consider then, because they are sending you their data, so you are the processor if you process data on their behalf and only on their behalf. You have to do like a small processing index, and you have to do the contracts. The processing index is less information than the one you have to do for the data you are a controller for, but it's actually in the law you have to do this as well. And there you have mainly the contact data of your own company as a processor, and of your controllers, of your client. You have to state the processing activities, and that helps for the contract, of course, that you have to make. Like you write, I'm doing backups, I'm doing maintenance and stuff like this. You have to state the categories, only the categories of the recipients, like IT provider again or something like this, and you have to state your technical and organizational measures. And that will be with a bit more details the contract, and there's also examples out there. So we had a session yesterday which was quite interesting about the processor stuff, and it's for you as a web business. It's better to be a processor to your client than a controller, because if you are the controller, you're responsible for that data. So try to be a processor and get a contract. And we were also discussing yesterday, what if you're not a processor? It's also, if you're, for example, sometimes I have a problem on a website and I need the support from an extension developer, and they offer to log into my system. Yesterday we had the example with the Xerox guy who is coming to the printer. That's also often with all the scans, there's data saved on the printer. So the Xerox guy comes to fix the problem with the printer, but he doesn't come to process the data. There's a difference. So you don't really need a contract with the man fixing your printer. But what's good to do is a non-disclosure agreement, so to make sure he's only fixing the problem, not processing the data. So if you have somebody to fix your problem on a website, and that's not on a regular basis, then consider if that one is going to be a processor, then you make a contract, which makes sense in some cases. If it's not the processor, because the person is not processing the data, only fixing a problem, for example, then you could make a non-disclosure agreement. And again, it's always about documentation. Write the stuff down, why you did it, how you did it, and also make sure in this agreement that you state that they are not processing, what they have to do to fix the problem, and that, for example, you will delete the account afterwards, and you inform before. So do that stuff. Okay, so now I have some examples from web businesses. So what to consider when you're doing different kind of data processing activities. So the first one would be newsletter. The legal basis for a newsletter would be consent. People have said, okay, you're allowed to send me an email, newsletter, and also the might be legitimate interest by controller. Yeah.
Well, I have a chemical company, mm-hmm. and they have kind of a problem because they've been in the newsletter. They have one newsletter list for important safety information.
Yeah.
So this is not optional. They have to send that to their client.
That's
so how would that?
There's for the purpose. I told at the beginning I'm missing the word. You have to have a purpose for your processing, and there's like it's a change of purpose, which is compatible. So if you have clients, they're actually your clients. For example, you're allowed to send them stuff like this. I mean, that's also like. It's life-saving, so probably. Of course, you're allowed to send this.
Okay. Okay.
If your company enforces like renaming the company or something, or moving the company from A to B, this is
for
fine.
Existing clients,
yeah,
is fine. If you have existing clients and they've bought something by you, like a service or product, you are allowed to send them information for this purpose still. It's a bit different, it's maybe not for the product, but it's important information. I mean, of course, you're allowed to send this, but do, again, inform them why you're sending it. Be transparent. Like, we've renamed the company, we have, I don't know, we have a new product that's now the new one, stuff like this. So, yeah. Also inform what information do you store and how long, like name, email address, and also consider there, I'll get all the points there now. Yeah.
Let you just an example.
Yeah.
And also be very, very, my mom is a doctor and she has to store, of course, medical data. And then at the first, what had been informed, they got to be told that if someone wants to have removed his personal data, you have to remove it.
Yeah.
And then she asked, this is strange because normally I have to keep the records for 10 years.
Yeah.
And the severe fine if I do not do that.
Yeah.
No, of course you have to keep that for 10 years. So be,
yeah,
ask them, and if you're not sure, ask them to confirm that written.
Yeah. Yeah, the better you get the information, what they want and what you're doing, also store that for you. Do something like a log as well, what you've done with the information. Yeah, so that's the for newsletters. And also consider there might be, if you have double opt-in and people sign up for the newsletter and they never click that confirmation link, get rid of that information at one point. Delete all those confirmed newsletter subscribers. They don't harm in the database, but imagine your site gets hacked and somebody takes all the email addresses and sends some stuff out of it, and it can be traced back to you. And that person has signed up, or the email was there like 5 years ago, and you never clicked that confirmation. Why do you still have this data? It's not necessary. There's scripts out there, and the providers will support you, I think. It takes time until everything's set up. But I also know, like for Office 365 in the back end, you already have to can set up when the emails or the data will be deleted. Also, I think Archimailing will do something about that. Yeah, so that's check what's data saved in your database. Of course, use SSL for your website. The people are transferring data, so make sure you have that. And if possible, it's now double opt-in should be standard. So then you can prove that the people gave consent themselves to get the newsletter. But that's nothing new in most of the countries. That's there already for some time. Yeah. Webshop. If you have a webshop, of course, you have legal obligations to save the data. Do you have to write invoices? You have to send that. You have a contract. You have to send the product. Of course, you're. And you. have to transfer the data to the delivery company, whatever. Of course you have to do that, and you're allowed to. But consider also how long do you need that data. Use SSL for your website. Inform what data is stored and how long for the web shop. And inform your visitors and customers about cookies if you need to store it. But there's that also the e-privacy directive, which will be published probably next year. There will be things going on with cookies, so there's lots of different opinions right there. Yeah, that's a whole own issue. Only collect necessary data, so if you don't need birth date, don't ask for it to order something. Also check for your payment providers if they safely transmit the data, what data they save. Inform the people what's going on, be transparent. Also, are you using like a currency converter? There might be external scripts where data is transmitted to, so make that transparent. Tracking, Google Analytics and stuff. So I have many customers, they have Google Analytics, but they never ever look there, so get rid of it then. I mean, it doesn't really make sense. As soon as the people go to the website, the IP address is transmitted, and you have to offer opt-out. There's lots of documentation online. to do that. And you have to, if you use those tracking tools, they are processor. And Google offers you to do a processing contract with them. You just have to go to Google Analytics, log in, and do the stuff there. And then you have a processing contract, that's fine. You have to inform the people, you're fine to use it, but do the stuff right.
You're saying you have to provide an update by the person viewing the website?
I have to update?
Google Analytics.
For, yeah? Sorry, again, please. If I,
you say provide an opt-out.
Yeah.
Opt-out to who?
To the visitor of the website.
Really? So yeah. You don't want them to track their information? They're saying,
yeah,
I don't want to track my information.
Yeah, yeah. There's opt-out possibilities for by Google Analytics, but there's now getting more like general like plugins or stuff that you can say don't store any cookies. That's not necessary. So there's different levels going on now with cookie stuff. But it's basically about cookies and about what data is transmitted.
To follow up on that, how does one, if you practically have the responsibility of providing an opt out, I read that since all contemporary browsers now have plugins which do just that, it is enough in your privacy statement to link to those and say these are available if you want to opt out, this is how you do it.
Yes.
Okay.
That would so be. You do you have a privacy statement? You state it there. But you should have the cookie pop up also.
Yeah,
so
yeah, specifically for analytics.
Yeah. So you should make sure they're not saving cookies before they actually accept it. But there's tools and they work.
Yeah, there's a problem. For example, in Jumbo setting a cookie just when you visit the website.
Yeah, but that's different, because that's just a session cookie and there's no personal data stored,
okay.
And it's deleted as soon as you close the browser. That's fine. And for some online shops, you need cookies to work.
Mm.
That's fine too. But inform the people. But tracking cookies are not necessary, so there should be an opt-out. 5 more minutes. Contact forms. Only connect necessary data and also use HTTPS to transmit that data. Consider in Joomla, if you use the contact form, the standard contact form, the content is sent through email, and email is like postcard, so everybody can read that, so inform your people what's going to happen. If you click that button, the data is transmitted through email. They know what's happening then. If they don't want that information to be transmitted through email, they will find another solution. Or you offer other solutions. You could use other forms or where the data is only sent. You got a new contact through your website and only the link is sent maybe, but not the data itself. So that's also an issue. Also check in for your form components, check in your database what data is stored and how long. There's data for years sometimes, which is not needed anymore. Delete all data, and there's scripts to delete data. Peter, for example, has one for Ars Form Pro, which is offering on GitHub. And also know that others having these scripts too. So that stuff's happening now. So extension developers are offering solutions to get rid of old data. Also paper documents, if you print them. Printers sometimes have internal disk storage, so take care of that, but save there if there's more people who can read that data. What do you do with misprints? And also really destroy paper, not just put it to the garbage. You should shred it, actually. If there's personal data on it, not only your own, but of course of your clients and so. And also, where do you store your binders? Is it like in an office where everybody can walk in? That would be high risk for the data, so you're not allowed to do that. Yeah, other stuff. There's services like Watchfully, My Joomla, for example. You have to check. Because they say they are not really doing stuff, but they are actually processing the data. They're doing backups, they're doing reading through the code. You can read the passwords and stuff. So it's difficult. I cannot really give you a final answer about that. Always check, remove data that you don't need anymore. That's by law, you have to do that now. You have to reason to clean up your storage. Also, there's third-party extensions now, and very important stuff is that Joomla, the project, is going to do release 3.9. And we should really all try to get that in a good state and support and test and give information. And there's, of course, you have to check with cloud services. like Dropbox, and normal Dropbox will not be, private Dropbox will not be GDPR compliant. There will be a business solution and education, and they say they will be compliant with that one. There's information on the company's website, go there. Google Drive, normal Google Drive, private, free versions, not GDPR compliant. So if you save personal data there, that can be read by others that you don't really want. So there will be there's G Suite, for example, for Google. That's a they will be they the big ones offer GDPR compliance and solutions. So check their sites. Yeah, of course, social media. But who's on social media has already said they would be there. So there were hands in the back.
Yeah. Dropbox explicitly state that they do meet the requirements.
But for the private version. Okay,
just
that's new.
It just says on their site, without clarifying or specifying any
okay.
version, it says we will meet the requirements by the
okay, so, okay, that's new information to me. I know they're doing it for the business part and for the educational part, but I didn't know for, maybe they do it for the general as well, which would be nice.
iCloud, does somebody know? Because I've heard it's not.
I know, so far I know not, but I don't have any up-to-date information. Okay, so if you're a web agency, try to be transparent as possible, do compliance. It's good for your reputation if you can state it. Contact your clients and help them. It's important. And it's also good for your high quality support you can give them. So that's, yeah, it's actually an opportunity for you. To do before May 25. We cannot finish everything until May 25. So update your privacy statement that's visible from the outside. There might be services checking in websites what scripts you're using, because that's public. You can see that. Try to get the right information or try to get rid of those scripts, because we don't know what's going to happen. Germany is really a bit specific because the people are waiting to find others. So you have to check there more detailed than in other countries probably. Check all your external scripts, check your contact forms where you collect data. If you have a statement there, what's going to happen with the data, if you transmit it, what you're doing with it. And link to your privacy statement, put the data there, be transparent. Get HTTPS for your website, all websites, I would actually say. Yeah, and provide the appropriate security measures, so secure the data. So I think GDPR is a chance. Let's take it, and yeah, that's it. We have some tips on our website, and I'm around. You can ask me also later on if you want. Are there any questions? Okay.
How about the alternative content in web pages, for example, from Instagram or Facebook?
Yeah, it depends. Like Facebook is sending data back to Facebook. I think it's not okay actually with personal data, because Facebook is also sending data from people that are not on Facebook. That's the problem.
Yeah.
So. There should be like an opt-in to see that stuff or to load this stuff. I don't know about Instagram, to be honest. I don't know. Yeah.
What I've read is that those services are using their own cookies if they're embedded.
Yes. Yeah. That's. I think it's.
Anyway.
I think it's not GDPR compliant, and you might have to. Also, Google Maps is problematic, because it's as soon as you open a page, it's trying to get your position. So there will be stuff where you click and then it's loading the scripts. So you have to opt in to use it. Okay, there's one.
Would it be enough if you tell on your site, as soon as you click to Google Maps, be sure that your data can be...
Yes, but then you have to make sure that Google Maps is not loaded before that. Okay.
So only a link?
Yeah, only after clicking.
Yeah.
But if I send them, it's just a link of a page and I send them to Google Maps, it must be okay, because then it's
okay.
External window and it's not my problem anymore.
Yeah.
They're often talking
yes.
on the site.
Yeah.
It's not
yeah.
my problem.
Yeah, you're right. If you just offer the link to Google Maps and you don't embed it in your own website, that's how I mean it.
Yes.
So you said this is Google Maps, you click and then you're on Google Maps, they leave your website. That's okay, that's fine. Yeah.
That was my question. do you know how far Google is with a processing contract for other services like Google Maps, Google Recapture, Google Fonts? Because all this stuff is going directly with Google, the IP address of
yeah.
your clients.
I don't know the status today, but I know, for example, yesterday Google sent out to the users a privacy statement. I was just reading it. There's lots of information there. I don't know about the contracts, like processing contracts with the other services, but I guess Google will be compliant, informative, whatever. So they will try. I mean, they cannot. Yeah.
We'll all burn.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
I'm very concerned about the grey areas.
Yeah.
What happens when there are two persons of your ilk, or lawyers, for example, who actually disagree about what the exact terms are about of the GDPR, and there is big dispute? How is this solved?
I don't know.
And this thing about the newsletters, opt in, opt out.
Yeah.
I actually questioned this already. The head of the site went to the lawyer. He's got a GDPR lawyer. And the lawyer said something different from what you said. And now I don't know. Now
I'm always
if that, I don't, I can't.
He said opt in and opt out. You can do either. There's
for
only
all,
certain
is it
things.
For all data or for from going on from now?
Well,
I mean, there's not.
The,
well,
the newsletters things.
Yeah.
I mean,
there's so many options. I mean,
yeah.
It depends on the case. You have to see where do the addresses come from, like from history. Was there a consent? How did you store that consent? Were there double opt-in or just normal opt-in? But or did you just collect emails from somewhere? So. It
so
depends.
It's very complicated, so therefore, in
yes.
fact, in the end, you need a lawyer.
No, I don't think so, but you have to consider all the stuff. I mean, if you know that for the people have to consent to send them an email, a newsletter. If you have had double opt-in on your website and the people were signing up to the newsletter through the website, nothing's changing here. You just continue sending your email newsletter. But if you're not sure where the email addresses come from, then you might consider what to do. So
I'm just very concerned about
yeah.
non-profits and small businesses who can't
but what
get
can,
a lawyer. I mean,
yep,
they just
yeah,
got
yeah.
the funds.
Okay, I have an example maybe.
Can I first
also
related
to
yeah.
except to the
yeah.
thing, I think.
But 1 second. I also wanted to, if you're sending newsletters and you always have the sign out link, and you're sending it to the people, and you have a rather small, like non-profit organizations, you have, for example, a rather small base of people who are there.
Yeah.
If they complain and said, I don't want to get it anymore, just delete them. I don't know it's not very specific data, it's an email address. The risk is really low of something to happen. So that's not really GDPR, that's about marketing and spam and stuff. That's something else. It's not about personal data. So consider what's the problem with getting an email address. It's about storing to protect that data, but to send it, that's yeah.
So if it only applies to somebody who's already given their email address voluntarily,
yeah,
which they have to do to join up in our case,
yeah.
But specifically
yes.
given it to receive a newsletter,
yeah,
possibly.
Yeah.
Yeah, well that's it.
Yeah, that's
I'm
fine.
Questioning about the checkboxes.
Yeah.
You know,
but maybe
checkboxes for
yeah.
newsletters and that sort of thing, if they is. Opt-in, opt-out, or voluntary.
Yeah. We're running out of time. Do you have the, maybe Frank, can we just talk, the three of us, or?
Yes, okay.
Okay.
So I got a newsletter, and I wonder what to do with it, because I got an ASIO mailing newsletter
yeah.
where I propagate a couple of tips for health, and also for strength courses.
Yeah.
So people double opt in there.
Yeah.
And I got it also from a small store where people can actually buy them.
Yeah.
It has also, once you are buying stuff, you want to also receive the newsletter and they have to also opt
yeah.
in for that. So, but I never clear specified to this audience what newsletter I'm sending, that I of course promote my own newsletters and so
But you were sending it already.
Oh yeah, for a couple of
yeah,
days.
So yeah, so what? I mean, nothing
well,
really
okay,
changes
yeah,
there.
Yeah. Was a press request,
yeah.
So some said, no, you cannot.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks for listening.